Exciting. We're going to go with 3 TechPint t-shirts. So just get your brain worrying now. We're going to ask 3 very difficult questions. And the first people to answer them will win a t-shirt. Tracy's there with a box of love. Okay, so what is Eric's last name?
Nice.
I heard a girl's voice back there. Yeah, she got it. Is that Megan?
Yep.
Tracy yep. Up here. Okay, number 2. How many tech pints have we had in Akron?
2.
Oh, yes.
Everybody said it.
He said it louder.
I feel it was you, though. I feel it. Now, you are closest, so I might be... what date will TechPint next be held in Cleveland?
16.
There you go. Yeah. All right. I think I had that prepared. Right here, Tracy. Okay, without further ado, I'd like to invite up to the stage their Senior Vice President of Laird Technologies and founder of Summit, Ron Seide. So Ron didn't want to play any music, and then he chose that. So,
crime fighter, race car driver, you guys got it all going on.
I've got some tough questions here for Ron, but we really want you guys to take part in the conversation too. So if you could ask your questions via Twitter, the hashtag TechPint, I guess. Daniel's here, going to be looking out for the stream, and he'll hand me questions. So please do that. And we're going to give away 3 t-shirts to people who ask questions via Twitter. Well, thank you for joining us, Rob.
Thanks.
Yeah. So you've sold your company Summit back in 2012.
Yeah.
Could you just tell me a little bit about what Summit was or is, and
sure.
What kind of product and service you were selling?
Yeah. So. It's been a while since I've done the elevator pitch, but it was our job is to provide wireless data communications that keeps mobile devices on enterprise-class networks in challenging RF environments. And so if you've seen those handheld mobile computers when you turn in a car at the rental car agency, good that our radio's in a device like that. Enterprise-class networks, so that contrasts like a Wi-Fi infrastructure. Sure, that contrasts a Wi-Fi infrastructure like in a business as opposed to your house, and then finally challenging environments like factories and warehouses and airports and container ports and hospitals and places like that. And so imagine a forklift truck with a mobile computer on it, and it's traveling at 30 miles an hour, and there's metal on one side and wood on the other side, and the nearest access point is 300 meters away, and if you lose connection for more than 200 milliseconds, you lose your database application, the guy starts beating on the side of the thing. So our job was to keep mobile devices on networks in the really crappiest environments with the most anal retentive IT managers, and we kind of build a business around doing that. So the same Wi-Fi you find in your laptop or your smartphone, but for industrial applications and later for medical applications.
So a really simple solution and problem that, no, so you were working in Cisco at the time. Okay, I'm going to take a quick shh to the people in the back. Just quick shh. Anybody in the bar, just kind of talk in low, dulcet tones, as opposed to high-pitched natter. All right.
That was very dulcet on your part, by the way.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, I'm working on that.
Yeah.
The mics help. So you were working for Cisco at the time.
Yeah.
And I kind of bring that up because what you were saying there is really high-tech. What brought you to be able to talk like that, to be able to build a company like that? How did being in Cisco influence or impact the building of your company?
Yeah, I mean, so it was myself and 4 partners, and we were at Cisco. We had been doing Wi-Fi for various periods of time, anywhere for, you say, 6 years to 8 years. And so we really learned the industry, we learned the business, we learned the technology, and I think that's really instructive. I mean, if you're jumping out and trying to do a startup, having some clue as to what you're doing is, turned out in our case, to be fairly helpful. So we had that background, we were able to leverage that and take really almost an incremental step in a way of starting the company. I mean, there are startups where you just jump into something, you've got no idea what you're doing, and sometimes those work out really well. In other cases, it's more of a spin-out almost. And ours was sort of in the middle of the two of them. It wasn't as though Cisco sanctioned what we were doing. In fact, they were a little angry when we left. But on the other hand, it was just a step from Cisco.
And it seemed, so you had your role in Cisco. You were working with this technology. So you saw opportunity that was just kind of blindingly obvious?
Yeah, so from our perspective, this was a great opportunity to start a company, grow a company, contribute in our own small way to building the IT community here in Northeastern Ohio. From Cisco's perspective, it was an $11 million business in a business unit that at the time was doing around $500 million in a company that was, you know, multiple billions of dollars. And so I guess to the extent there's a point to all of this, it's that, you know, one organization's cast-offs, their trash, can be gold for another organization that's working at a different sort of scale, a great way to, you know, have that nucleus to start with and then grow from there. I mean, when we left Cisco, there was one set of fairly well-defined customers. By the time we were done at Summit before we got acquired, we had grown that by a factor of three. We had gone into different sorts of markets. We had that starting point that we knew very well. And so we were able to, you know, get early momentum and then build off that, as opposed to having to just, you know, start from scratch.
Yeah, I remember when I was talking to you before, I kind of had a picture of the market that you entered, where there were these big players. I was just looking at a pie chart. There was big player targeting this section of the market, big player this market, and then there was tons of all our smaller niche markets
yeah.
that you were able to tackle. How did what was your reasoning behind your approach to market that kind of differed from what Cisco would do?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a marketer by trade. I'm not an engineer, as my engineering colleagues will tell you. I'm not an engineer. And so for us, it really was start out with the notion of find a set of customers, or better still, redefine, create a set of customers, and then be able to articulate what it is you're doing for them that's better than what everyone else is doing. So who's your customer? What are you doing? Why is this better than what other people are offering them? And then beyond that, I mean, we started out in Wi-Fi, and today, then we moved into Bluetooth and Bluetooth Low Energy and other sorts of wireless datacom transports. But there's billions, I guess it would be, of Wi-Fi chips that are sold, Bluetooth that's sold every year. But like anything else, you've got the bell curve and you've got the long tail. And so there we are out way, 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 way down on the long tail. It's still millions of units per year. It's still tens of millions of dollars in terms of revenue. But it's a very, 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 very small specialized part of a much, much, much larger industry. And if you're looking to, you know, go out, start something up and have, you know, at least a double-digit percentage chance of success, as opposed to a single-digit percentage chance of success, finding that sort of application in the long tail that's very specialized, very well-defined, very defensible, is a decent enough way to start something up. It worked out okay in our case.
What was the size of the market? You know, there's the long tail and there's niche, but people are afraid to go after non-billion-dollar ideas. So, like, what did you see? What was the size
of
your
idea? Well, I think it depends on, you know, how you define people, right? So if you talk to like a VC, they're always wanting to swing for the fence. They're always going to be looking for that, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars or billion-dollar sort of opportunity. We sort of went a different direction. We were looking for markets that were sized more on the order of eight figures thereabouts. Now, the downside to that is that when you're talking to a VC or a so-called angel investor and you say it's a wonderful opportunity and if things all go really well in 5 years we'll be doing about $20 million, they're like, they're bored senseless, they just walk away. So then you have to figure out some other way of funding the company that doesn't involve necessarily equity funding, because they're looking for the really big story, they're looking for the really large number of dollars, and what they're really looking for is what's the exit strategy. You know, how do I walk away from this thing 5 years down the road, having, you know, done what, 100%, 1,000% on my investment? If you don't have a story like that for them, it tends not to work out really well. Then you're looking for friends, family, bootstrapping.
Yeah.
Whatever.
And then that leads me nicely on to the next question. When you left your job, you did not have any funding, nor did you ever take on any funding for this company whatsoever. How did you survive? How did you do that?
So what we did do is we got a running start. I mean, frankly speaking, we were all gainfully employed at Cisco, and in our evenings and our weekends, and yeah, frankly, sometimes during the day at work, we were plotting our exit. We were plotting, you know, starting the next company and Summit. And at one point, I had my Cisco laptop and I had my Summit laptop, and they sat next to each other on the desk. And fortunately, my boss was in San Jose, and so I could pull that off. So that's part of it. I mean, getting a running start at it. It's like, you know, when people are working as, newspaper reporters or in the patent office or something like that, they're working on their novel and it's in their desk drawer. So people are, you know, starting that transition thing. And we did that. And, you know, we were still putting in the hours at Cisco and all of that, but we were definitely sort of feathering from one thing to the next. To answer your question, we left at various points between November and March of 2005 and 2006, and we were shipping by June of 2006, and we were cash flow positive by November of 2006 because we'd just done so much planning up front so we could really just, you know, move from prototype into production very, very quickly after that.
So it must have taken some amount of personal capital to enter a high-tech business, though.
Yeah, oh yeah. Yeah, so we mortgaged our houses. You know, there were three of the five of us that had some equity in our homes, and we convinced our wives, in an epic example of salesmanship, to go ahead and mortgage the houses and took out bank loans. And this is interesting, too. So you go to the banks and you tell your story, and they're like, oh, this is a fantastic story. You guys have been successful. This is great. And then when you start talking about actually getting the loan, it's at that point they tell you, well, we are going to need real collateral here. Well, what about our story? Yeah, we need collateral. Look, seriously. Yeah. So houses are good collateral, and then, you know, they had a personal guarantee on there. And after like 5 years with First Merit, they finally gave us our houses back and took us off the. But you know what? I mean, if you really believe in what you're doing, if you've really done your homework, if you really understand your market, doing something as crazy stupid as mortgaging the house isn't that crazy stupid if you really believe you got a good solid handle on it. Conversely, if you're doing something far more speculative, my God, use someone else's money, not your own, by any means.
Because on one hand, it seems, because of your domain expertise and the way you approached it, it kind of seemed like a bit of a no-brainer of a business. But then it required a lot of guts and bravery to do it all the same, right?
I don't know, but I think desperation's probably guts and bravery. So for those of you who started something up, I mean, you guys know this, but I'll tell you, so even though this is, you know, as I said before, incremental and, you know, no-brainer and all that, I mean, at the same time, you're also waking up at 4 o'clock in the morning having sweated through your sheets because you're totally, totally panic-stricken about what you're doing. So even in these more straightforward types of things, there's just a staggering amount of stress that goes through. I drink now as a result. Beer.
You drank before.
Yeah, right. So
probably one thing that helped this whole process is that you had several founders. How many did you have again?
There were five of us.
So I think from my perspective, most people would kind of balk at having five founders because they're already thinking about how can we split 30 million between five of us, you know, yeah. Nothing.
Yeah.
So what was the pros and cons of five founders?
I used to characterize the five of us as being sometimes a band of brothers and sometimes the former Yugoslavia. It was, I think for tech in particular, you know, no one person is capable of doing all of the roles. It ranges from the commercial side to the technical side. So you've got, you know, the sales and marketing guy, you've got the finance guy, you've got the support guy, you've got the engineers. No one person is capable of doing that. And having some percentage of something as opposed to 100% of nothing, well, you know, the former is far better than the latter. And so we felt as though we needed to have a small, albeit complete, cohesive team that could really cover all the functional areas. And I think that when you do something like this, you've got to be, you know, sort of selfless about it. You've got to be very honest with yourself and say, you know, what am I really capable of doing and what am I not capable of doing? And then finding people with complementary skills to fill out the rest of that. And then beyond that, I think it's particularly important with a startup to not only have complementary skills, but also borderline complementary personalities. So, because it, again, it's stressful. It's really, really difficult. And if you are having personality issues with your partners, as we did, that just makes it even worse. I mean, the customers, the vendors, they're tough enough. If you're at your partner's throat, that's deadly. It's fatal.
It's funny. One of the things that I kind of spotted from the last tech point we did here and the other ones we did in Cleveland, I think Blake Squires spoke about it kind of best. When you're going to build a new business, really the best way to go about it is to look at it as you're building a company, and not to get kind of too stuck in the weeds about this small, I'm going to, you know, build a small bit of my product and try to get this out. So it's kind of, I'm kind of a little bit at odds. I know you know about agile development and what Eric was talking about, the lean principles, where you're really kind of eking out very small things and growing. But I have a feeling that if you spent your time gathering the smartest group of people you possibly can gather and then give them a vision, it's possible a business can be built that way too. Or, you know, what's the balance?
Yeah, I mean, so coming back to the notion of agile, and Eric talked about it too, and the notion of a minimally viable product. I mean, if particularly if you're bootstrapping, I guess I'll back up and say that, you know, I think sometimes that if you've got a bunch of funding, some folks may lack the discipline of really just, you know, getting to prototype, getting to production, getting to revenue. And if you bootstrap it in particular, you've got the luxury, if you will, the benefit of being totally panic-stricken because you're going to run out of money. So we, and I think a lot of other organizations, really narrowly define exactly what you're providing and for whom, and go after that with a laser-like intensity, just so you can get something, anything out there that's a real product, which can give you real money for. And then once having done that, then build upon it. And our first product was a single SKU. It was a compact flash .11bg radio supporting one horrible Microsoft operating system. That's all we did, but we knew that there were 7 customers that needed just that thing. We got it out, and then over time, we expanded it out to be, you know, various flavors of Wi-Fi and Bluetooth and supporting 4 different OSs and, you know, customers in a variety of different industries.
So if I was to ask what comes first, the team or the idea, it almost seems like there's a seed of an idea, then you get a team together to work on it?
I think it's the team. You know, I think, you know, good ideas are almost a dime a dozen. Yeah. You can sit there with, you know, 6-pack and your buddies and brainstorm all manners of different ideas, many of which under the right circumstances would be viable. Yeah. But then getting people stupid enough to come along with you and join and share the vision, that's the hard part, and keeping everyone together. And, you know, as we talk about, you know, Northeastern Ohio too, I mean, that's part of it as well, where, you know, this isn't Silicon Valley. This place is a much smaller tech community, but the degree to which we can all, you know, contribute to keeping people here and attracting people here and helping to build that critical mass, so you can start having one company start off of another and spin out of another and build those teams and reassemble those teams as necessary to do new things. That's really the necessary condition.
So you have an MBA, right?
Yeah.
So you were kind of in the MBA corporate world, then you spun out, you've built your own company. Now, being bought by Laird Technologies, you're kind of back in the big corporate world again. So how are you feeding what was Summit, but now is the Laird division, with the talent that you need in Akron, and how are you holding on to them? How do you keep people here?
It's a challenge. I mean, so, you know, when you sell your company, when you and your partners sell your company, you can say that this is something we're doing for the whole of the company, the greater good of everybody. There's truth to this. It's not a complete scam. But ultimately, it comes down to you making a decision that, yeah, I'm taking the money off the table, and there's a selfishness associated with it. So there you are. You've made a decision that's worked out pretty well for you, but what about everybody else? What about everyone else that you're working with? What about them? And so coming to Laird, the thing that really stays with me is, how do I make this a good decision for everybody? What can I do to make this place okay for everybody else? And actually, not even okay, ideally even better. And so, you know, it is a big 140-year-old company and publicly held and all the, you know, forgive me, all the bullshit that comes with a large corporation, and I'm trying really hard and